tell you from me, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know, it's really amazing you're going to applaud like that without using your hands. Wild group. How are you tonight? There's a light on those people up there. You're sitting in a light, aren't you?
Yes.
Why are they sitting in a light?
They want to be seen.
Somebody got a flashlight up there or something? I'm dedicating tonight's monologue to the economy. God knows they both need a lot of help. I'm Johnny Carson. I come on just before Barbara Walters. It's a valley. It's a valley. Well, you see, it's difficult to be out here without the band. It's tough to do the show without the music, although the band did it when they were here. Well, I have some good news and bad news tonight. The good news is, I think it's good news, is that Judge Sirica has ordered President Nixon, you know, to turn over 64 more Watergate tapes. The bad news is that Nixon made him a necklace and gave him to King Faisal Saudi Arabia. Very unusual type of jewelry. Did you see what the president, about the bottle he found?
That's great.
How many of you read that in the paper today? It's a true story. President Nixon was walking, I think, on Grand Cay Island in the Bahamas, in the Caribbean, whatever you call it, and a bottle washed up. It's not a joke. And he opened the bottle, and there was a note in there that somebody had written to their grandparents.
Right.
And the president of the United States finds it. He didn't open the bottle at first. He thought it was another subpoena. He said, that Jaworski will go to any lengths. But apparently a sailor...
Yes.
Did you read that? I don't remember
his
name.
On a helicopter carrier.
On a helicopter carrier, Guam had thrown it overboard, and the president got on the phone and called the people. That's crazy, isn't it?
That's sending a message.
Isn't that a great messenger?
Yeah.
It's kind of strange, though. Quite a state of affairs, and Judge Sirica can't find reach the president, but a wino can. Let's see what happened. The president's wife was in the news. She had a rather interesting statement in the paper today. She said that... She was talking about the tapes that were Watergate-related were more like love letters. It was in the paper today and meant for one person alone. And that was interesting. So I think what's going to happen, instead of an impeachment, they're going to ask for a divorce. I think that's what they're going to do, and I may be wrong there. Probably am wrong there. Here's an unusual item in the news. Pickpocket was picked up. I don't know what town it was. And a judge sentenced him. He didn't go to jail. He sentenced the pickpocket to wear mittens. That's true. It was in the paper. Guy kept picking pockets. Sentenced. The judge says, you must wear mittens. You know the first thing the guy did? He went out and stole the pair of mittens. A pair of mittens.
One thing that's nice about this tonight, you're in a great outfit to bomb in.
I go on the tube, I go down in style. Here's something you should be interested in. Yesterday, you know what they held at the Beverly Hills Hotel in Los Angeles?
Yes, the bartenders.
The annual bartenders convention.
Yep.
They actually have bartenders from all over the United States. They show up and they have a contest where all the bartenders mix their drink, and I guess they award a first prize for the most unusual concoction, and one drink was called the Velvet Kiss.
That's the winner.
That was the winner.
Yeah.
And some bartender, and whore from, did you see about him? Made the dry martini. The driest martini ever made.
How dry was it?
I want to tell you, this martini was so dry that later on they found dust in the urinals.
That's dry.
Weird joke. One of the runners-up was an impeachment daiquiri.
How does that go?
What?
How does that make?
Well, you start off by breaking into a refrigerator. Anyway, we have, should be an exciting show. Charlton Heston is with us tonight. Unusual man. I was having a sandwich in my dressing room and he walked in and the sandwich opened. We have one of the most controversial authors and a very outspoken gentleman, Mr. Norman Mailer, is with us tonight, and he always says what's on his mind. Young comedian with a very warped sense of humor, David Brenner, is back with us. And a gentleman, is it Ian Whitcomb? I believe it, Ian or Ian? Ian Whitcomb, who a few years ago had a big hit record and now is a writer and very interesting story. I think you'll enjoy him. What else do we have?
That's it.
We'll think of something else. Thank you for coming. We'll be with you in just a couple of days. Pussycat. I'm going fast, I want to tell you. Now meet Tabby's leading expert on what cats like to eat. Hi there. Shambhata. Love that recorded music.
Yes.
Jukebox Saturday night.
You gotta get some bassy.
What? Yeah, let's get some counter.
What are you doing?
I hurt my ear. I may have to take off. I may have to take off a few days. Oh, the pain.
Let me look at that.
We gotta get you right into the place.
Looks like about 3 days, doesn't it?
I think so. Mm.
That won't be well till after Tuesday.
Remember that in the service? We're going to the front tomorrow. Boom. Toe fell off. Anything new?
No, we had a big night last night with the affiliates.
They entertained all the affiliated stations from around the country. 225 stations were here, and boy, NBC went full blast, didn't they?
They didn't skimp. I'm
big do.
Chase
the next catering. Room.
That's first class.
Booze was flowing.
Oh, yes.
We did this, but you have anything to mention tonight before we get going?
I'm going to be in...
You're leaving. Are you always somewhere?
I'm going somewhere. Danny Thomas invited me down to help him with his big party in Memphis for St. Jude Hospital. And I'm the MC Saturday night. Alan King, Danny Thomas, I think Gladys Knight and the Pips. Good show in Memphis.
All right. Talking move around.
Best, your best, rather, to Memphis. Oh. Anybody want me to say hello to particularly?
Well, there was
Charlotte in the service?
No, that was a long time ago, and it was she probably wouldn't remember.
Maybe anyway. I can say hello to her and her family.
Don't say that.
Okay.
Remember if a few years ago or a few months ago, why am I pointing up like this?
I remember both of those times.
I don't.
I remember a few years ago and also remember a few months ago.
No, we, a gentleman.
Remember last Wednesday.
Up in the Pocono Mountains in Pennsylvania. Why am I doing
like
this?
Song.
Why am I doing this? Up in the Pocono.
Up in the Pocono Mountains.
There are a group of hotels, the honeymoon hotels, who cater almost exclusively to young married couples.
Right.
And they have what they call their, choose a honeymoon king and queen award of the week. And they send questionnaires out to all the couples to fill out. And Ira Silverman of the Mount Airy Birchwood, the summit in Penn Hills, sent us about a year ago some of the questionnaires. Now, we won't read the first and last names, but these are for real. These are not made up. They get asked the name, the bride's hometown, the marriage date, how did you meet, briefly describe your proposal. And then I guess they choose from this and give them a free week or something. But some of them are pretty hysterical, the way these people met. Miriam and Richard. Now, so these are ages are just 21, so young. How did you meet? I tripped him when we were roller skating. Briefly describe your proposal. Richie decided he wasn't getting enough sleep going back and forth to my house, so he said, let's get married. I think that's a tender proposal,
nice,
you know?
Yes.
Now he's getting a lot of sleep, and that's... let's see, Roseanne and Dennis. When did you meet this? Briefly describe your proposal. Went skydiving. And he said, would you marry me? If not, he said he wouldn't open his chute.
Wow.
So she said yes.
Yes.
It was either that or scrape him off Chicago. I said, Leslie and Skip. How did you meet? Smashed on frozen daiquiris. When did you meet? Around July 15th.
Well, they were friends.
Briefly describe your proposal. Smashed on cheap red wine. Sitting on beanbag chair at local steak and brew. She had a stomachache. This is a wonderful, wonderful arrangement.
So they got married.
Sharon and Eugene, how did you meet? Eugene's friend tried to make out with me, but Eugene was a better talker. That's married, married to mine. Sandra and Charles, briefly describe your proposal. Threw me down on the bed in my apartment in Erie. It certainly was Erie, no. And asked me flatly, can you stick with me?
That's poetic. That man could be a writer.
Or something like that. I'll briefly describe your proposal. We were in bed, and Tom told me he wanted to get a tattoo on his arm of my name. I said, but you'll never be able to take it off. And he said, I don't want to because I want you to be my wife. And of course, I said, yes. That's kind of tender.
That's nice, yes.
Aw.
That's nice.
Then he turned to her and said, by the way, what's your name?
Yeah, that's right.
Joan and John. Some of these kids are so young, 18, 19 years old. Oh, they met at an Army recruiting office when we were both signing up. Describe your proposal sitting on Joan's couch in the living room, talking.
That's the old tradition.
Probably about the training films from the Army.
Yes.
Lisa and Timothy, how'd you meet? Get this. I would pick Lisa up every morning, and before school, we would both split a six-pack of beer. Now, can you imagine when you're going to school that you'd split a six-pack of beer before you go to school?
Arithmetic would be very strange.
Susan and Larry. Now, this is interesting. How did you meet? We were both born 3 days apart in the same hospital.
Come on.
We were both born 3 days. Her mother had the same room, March 10th to March 13th, 1952. These people were born. Where did they meet? In the back of an incubator? How would you know? How did you meet? And they met. And they met. And they. Apparently they met. Well, how could you meet when you're 3 years old?
3 days old.
3 days old. How would that work out?
The whole thing is a fake.
What?
Tear that out. That's no good.
And he said, would you like to come to my mother's for dinner?
Probably.
Whatever you folks make out of that, I haven't the slightest idea. Patty and Chuck. Patty was watching TV. It was a battle between me and the boob tube. I got her on a commercial. I hope it was one of those 2-minute commercials rather than a station break. That's. How did you meet? Sarah and Thomas. First, he started asking me questions about meats. And then he asked for my name. Oh, I see, he worked in a supermarket. Weird. Christine and Tom. How'd you? Tom bought Chris as a slave for $1.
Hmm.
I don't understand that, do you?
Oh, I'd like to find out where that market is.
Brief described proposal. I asked whether she wanted to get married in the back seat of a car. Some of these people are going to have a long life ahead. How'd you meet? We were scratching each other's backs. Where did you meet? At a party in the woods. These are two bears. How did they get in here? Hey, this is nice. Margaret and John, where did you meet? It was right here on the couch watching Johnny Carson show. I said, Fish?
Fish?
Her nickname.
Oh.
Fish. During our show.
Yes.
And she probably held up a can of Alpo and says, we'll be back in a minute. And that was a nice thing. Do you believe this one, Joanne and Walter? My tie got stuck in her zipper. Well, that used to be funny. How did you describe your proposal? I proposed in a garage and she couldn't back out.
Oh.
Huh? You think that's? Well, those are weird. But anyway, I wonder who the winner was. So thank you. I thank Mr. Silverman from the Mount Airy, back in Pennsylvania, for sending us those. Those are kind of interesting. Tonight we have Charlton Heston, Norman Mailer, we have David Brenner, and Ian Whitcomb. There. Are we back?
We are back.
I can never tell anymore. My first guest tonight is not here yet. I'm getting one of these.
Yes.
My first guest you'd like to meet, but unfortunately, he's not here. No, he's here now.
He's coming around the back.
He is one of the most distinguished members of the film industry, and he's just completed filming on a new movie called Earthquake, and currently working on Airport 75, which I suppose is a follow-up on Airport.
That's a very good supposition.
I would guess. I never saw Airport. I understand it's very good. It was a good picture. Would you welcome, please, Mr. Charlton Heston.
Nothing like an ovation of a crew of six.
Thought you had just come down from the mountain with the tablets. Well, good to see you again.
Nice to see you, John.
I missed you up in Las Vegas last weekend. That's one of the few that you missed, because I know you're a real tennis
buff. That was quite a tournament, too.
Yeah, Alan King really puts on a show up there, a first-class show at Caesar's
Rodney
Palace.
George played a pretty good match, didn't he?
Yeah, I suppose people who aren't tennis buffs might get bored with people talking about tennis, but I think it's becoming a more popular sport, and lots of people are playing it. And to watch Rod Laver up there the other day, fellas.
Well, as you said,
absolutely remarkable.
Alan King, that's just another sport than what we're hacking around for.
I said it's a game with which I'm not familiar.
Right.
And I ran into a young Tom Gorman, who was about 28 years old and a very nice young man. And he was leaving the airport that day, and we were standing in the lobby. And he says, "You know, it's a little bit depressing." And I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Well, when I was in school and I was thinking about becoming a professional," he said, "I figured, you know, Rod Laver would probably be retired by the time I turned professional." Because he said many tennis players by 30 kind of hang up the game or a little slower. And he says it's very defeating, because here's Laver, I think, is going to be 36 next year and is still playing and so remarkable. He said it's awfully defeating to go out. He says, because you can't psych yourself up that you're better than he is.
Yeah,
he said the only way you can beat him is, he says, if you play superbly and great, and the other, and he's off his game.
Yeah.
So he says, "I thought he'd be retired, and he's still playing." You were up there for the trip, but I didn't see you playing up there. Were you?
No, I wasn't in Vegas.
Well, that's probably why I didn't see you up there. You're playing well, though. You play.
Well, if we're talking about that other game.
Though I'm in the kind of a game that the amateurs play. But you started when? You've been at it for a while?
10 years ago. Too late to ever learn it well.
I only started last year, and that's it's hopeless, really.
Well, you can learn to do it. You can learn the strokes and the strategy. You can get in the condition. But it's a game that if you start it after you're 12 years old, there's a top limit on how good you can get. You know, it's the reflexes.
I guess all the great people started when they were kids, didn't they?
Sure. Uh-huh. There's no question.
Have you finished Earthquake already?
Earthquake. Los Angeles is in ruins. No.
Yeah, well, somebody who was on that the other day we were talking was on the show. Was in that. It was also
David Gardner, George Kennedy, Olivia Bujold.
Who was it?
Victoria Principal.
Victoria Principal, yeah.
Beautiful girl.
She said that was a fascinating fascinating picture.
It was quite a thing to work on. I think everyone is, especially that lives in the San Andreas Fault, as most of us in Southern California do, is kind of a macabre fascination with the subject of earthquakes. And you know, I've done some interviews about the picture, and they say, now, what attitude do you take? And I said, earthquakes are bad for you, you know. What are you going to do?
Maybe harmful to your health. Yeah. And yet most people don't get up and move.
No,
you know, and they live with that possibility.
Well, I hope the picture's a big success, and it persuades a lot of people to move out of California. That's all this part of the world lacks, you know. We need a little more elbow room.
Yeah. Now, when you did the Airport 75, when you did a picture before...
Skyjack.
Yeah, didn't you have to learn... we talked about that briefly one night, too. You got in the
707
simulator and went through all of the procedures.
This one is about a 747.
And so you had to redo the whole thing, huh?
I went down to Dallas, where they have the only 747 simulator in the country. American Airlines runs it. It is an incredible machine.
You get the actual feeling that they can create almost any conditions.
They can.
Can they not?
You are sitting
visually,
the flight deck of a 747, and anything you do to the controls not only are registered on the instruments, but you hear it happen and you see it happen. There's a visual component built in for, I think, another $1.5 million the American Airlines people.
In other words, if you're coming in for a landing or something and you do something wrong.
And they read into it, they say, "Give us Heathrow Airport in London. Twilight, ceiling 1,200 feet, visibility 5 miles. Mm. And there you are. And if you, you're coming in and you let down the landing gear and you hear it go down, you hear it, and the airspeed drops, the flight attitude changes, and it's an incredible...
Did you have any bad boo-boos at all?
No, I survived, Johnny.
Yeah.
I survived. But what was kind of interesting, one of the premises of this picture is that on a 747 in flight, right, they are, incidentally, incredible aircraft. They really are.
Pilots say it's the best ship and the safest thing.
Yes,
they love
in the air. There's no question.
Right.
And but the premise of the story is that a 747 in flight is struck by a light aircraft on the flight deck, knocks out a corner of the flight deck, a big chunk, right wide open, either kills or disables all the flight qualified personnel in the crew, the pilot, the co-pilot, so on. And but the plane is still flying, it's on autopilot, and they can sustain that kind of an impact, but there's nobody can land the plane. And so
that's not
steward,
much to look forward to, is
no,
it?
No, it's not.
So far, so good. Yeah. You know, yeah. They said the plane
now
is
for
now
the
for the bad news. We'll be able to fly for another 2 hours. Now the bad news, nobody can land it. Now, so in other words, you tell the passengers.
Well, and the premise is that one of the stewardesses, who has no flight training, played by Karen Black, is talked through some level turns because they're only at, I think, 2,500 feet in the Salt Lake City area, where there are mountains that are higher than that.
Right.
So you can't just keep flying straight. And one of the airline executives, played by me, talks her through some level turns from the ground till they can get somebody into the aircraft by helicopter that can land the plane.
It would be possible, strangely enough.
The Air Force says it's possible.
If somebody is cool and followed explicitly the instructions, I think almost anybody who could follow those directions would
level fly. This was one of the things that we tested down in Dallas, because many of the pilots that have read the script that I've given it to, about half and half, some of them said, no, you couldn't do it.
I think while they're in flight, yes. Landing may be a whole different thing, you know, and actually doing that procedure.
But we tried a couple of stewardesses from the training school that didn't know how to fly.
Right.
And we brought them over, and the instructor talked one of them through a level turn. Never been in a plane before.
That's fascinating.
And I talked the other one through, and so now I'm convinced that it's possible.
Great. Let me take a brief pause here, and we'll be right back after this short word from one of our sponsors. Welcome back. We're talking with Chuck Heston. You've played so many different varied roles in your life, and I suppose you get tired of some of the questions, but a lot of these, like the thing in the airport, require a lot of pre-preparation, learning to fly
a
707.
That's kind of an interesting part of the work.
And right? When they played Ben-Hur, replayed it again here a couple of weeks ago, yeah. I watched the whole thing again because that was one of the great spectacles ever made, and you were superb in it. And, of course, everybody's waiting for that great...
The race.
...chariot scene at the end, which was absolutely...
It was fixed, you know.
Fixed, yeah.
I knew I was going to win.
But everybody says, how did they do that? And
very, very carefully.
Because obviously you had to drive in some of those scenes, yeah. In a great many of them.
Yeah, most of it, yeah.
Now, did you go to a chariot school? Because most of them are closed, you know, now. Yeah. There wasn't a hell of a
it's
big
very little
hall.
Demand for that.
You don't get in the yellow pages and say, chariot school.
No. That's true. I went over 2 months before we started shooting. Fortunately, I'd ridden and been around horses a lot
right.
In my life. But driving a chariot, something else again, and I never had driven a team, let alone a four-horse team.
Right.
And I was spent 2 months learning to drive a little bit.
Some
is,
professional.
Yeah, Yakima Kanat.
Oh yeah, the great stuntman who directs.
Sequence, the greatest stuntman, the legendary stuntman
right.
In history.
He's in his 70s now, isn't he? And
yeah.
Still active.
His son Joe Kanat is now the greatest stuntman alive and one of the best second unit directors alive. And Joe doubled me for the fall in it. And doubled me for the stuff I didn't drive, but his dad taught me to drive. It's one of many skills I've collected that for which I have no further use.
Now,
anybody need a chariot driver?
Yeah, you did the football. You played the
in number
the
one,
aging quarterback.
I spent about 5 months, not every day, you know,
right.
But over a period of 5 months with Craig Fertig of SC, the quarterback coach of SC, and then down with the New Orleans Saints, learning to look like a pro quarterback a little bit.
Right.
And, I did a picture with Max Schell called Counterpoint, in which I was supposed to be a symphonic conductor. I learned to do that a little bit, again, to look like right. You can do it. And that took several months of work. And then when I played Michelangelo, I had to learn to paint the Sistine ceiling, and then...
You used a ruler, didn't you?
To wallpaper.
Rex Harrison said what?
He said, I've changed my mind. We're going to wallpaper.
Have you ever had any injuries during any of these things?
I cracked a rib doing number one.
The football thing?
Yeah.
You know, pro football, probably you would. That was about the roughest thing you could
get
involved in.
Well, it was a planned shot, and those guys are superb athletes, you know, and but they've got to come at you, what, 70% or so, or
right.
It looks ridiculous. And they knew exactly what they were going to do, but I turned in midair, and a guy was supposed to catch me with his shoulder pad and lay off it, and he was off his feet, too, and he caught me with his helmet. And they said you could hear the crack from the sidelines. Mm. And I fell, and of course the wind was knocked out of me, and that bit where they come over and they're lifting your belt, you know, like this, and I like this, and this guy comes over and leans over, he says, "Welcome to the NFL."
That's considered a minor injury, a cracked rib. They just put a little tape around you and send them back in half of the time.
Funny.
When you first started, it's always fascinating, and people are interested when they meet people who are so well-known and been successful, what they did in the early days, and were there any times in your career when you lived in New York, didn't you, with your wife,
in
Lydia?
In Hell's Kitchen, yeah.
Yeah, in trying to get into acting.
That was
and
a
so
nice
forth.
Neighborhood, then.
Hell's Kitchen was a...
Well, we never had any trouble. We had people we liked lived around us. I remember the fellow lived underneath us rented a gun.
Rented a gun?
Yeah, he did. He had no record, he was on no wanted lists or anything. He wouldn't dream of committing a felony himself,
right.
But he would rent a gun.
Just in case.
Yeah, if you wanted to hold up somebody.
I mean, you could rent the gun from him?
That's right, yeah. That's no kidding. Yeah. But it really was a nice neighborhood. We lived in a fourth floor. It was.
Sounds
well,
a guy
you.
Who rents guns below you. What'd you pay in those days in the Hell's Kitchen?
$30 a month.
$30 a month.
Then I started doing movies, and we finally moved from there when I realized, by mistake, one year I got a car and I ended up with it back east, so I garaged it across the street from where I lived, and I suddenly realized after about 4 months I was paying more to garage the car than I was for the apartment.
Did you ever get discouraged when you were trying to break into acting and say, hey, maybe this is not the direction I want to go, and...
You know, that's
it's too
a funny
insecure.
Thing. It's a ridiculous way to make a living. It's impossible.
I suppose most people's parents, usually if you find you're going into acting or theater, they say, get a nice trade.
Yes.
You know, make waste baskets or something.
Get a good profession.
Yeah.
But I can't, in other words, logically, if you're going to make a living acting, you're out of your mind because you can't do it.
Right.
But I can't remember... Going through that, I was reasonably lucky early on.
Right.
My wife got work before I did. She got a play on Broadway before I did and got a lead before I did. But I began to make a minimal living fairly early on. But I guess when you're 19, you can absorb a lot of disappointment.
Yeah, and if you get that measure of success fairly early, you'll say, hey, this is not too bad.
You're going to make it.
Your son's in a marine biology, is he not?
Down at UCSD, yeah.
Yes, is that what he's going to do with his life?
Yeah, he's thinking of transferring to UCLA next year, which would be nice to have him home. But
I know you have to leave early tonight, but I know you wanted to mention something, and not to particularly leave on a downer, but it is worth talking about, because I read an article on this over the weekend, and the alarming thing was that you have something to do with the suicide prevention. And the interesting thing I read, I think it was in the Los Angeles Times this week, that there's a great deal of that among the young people in this country. Of high school and college age, which was not always so, but it seems to be one of the highest rates.
The frightening thing about those two statistics that terrify me about suicide, one, it is one of the major causes of death in this country. While we've been talking, someone in the United States has committed suicide, for example, on this show.
Show wasn't that bad.
Scary.
Excuse me, I'm sorry. I should have said that. I know what you're trying to make the point, but that is alarming. We must, 25 or 30,000 people a year, something like that?
30,000 a year, which is, about half the number of people that are killed in automobile accidents. And it's one of the major sufferers from suicide are not obviously the victims themselves, but their friends and families. And about the only thing the suicide prevention people can give you to deal with this is there's a lot of myths about suicide, you know. If someone says he's going to commit suicide, he's not going to do it. That's not true. Almost everyone that commits suicide speaks
made a threat
before
time.
And or people will make kind of inept attempts at suicide, which clearly aren't going to work out. And they say, well,
it's a
he's
warning,
just looking for attention. Of course he's looking for attention. He's in desperate need of help.
Right.
And it's curious that this is kind of a, if you can call a suicide a disease, and I don't know what else to call it, it's certainly a major killer, major health problem. The number of people that it affects it makes it worthy of concern, and it's something that is hidden still. People with cancer,
right,
or tuberculosis used to conceal that.
They don't want to mention that a member of the family might have.
But the worst thing you can say is, oh, his father killed himself, you know. Even today, that's something no one ever wants to mention.
Like it's genetic or something, which
it's
not, of course. In many communities, I know they have like self-help lines, don't they, or hotlines for that. If somebody is in a depressed mood or like that,
there is help that they can get. There are, in most major cities, organizations that deal with suicidal depression, which is obviously the cause of suicide, and it's
so people could probably check with their local community or chamber of commerce,
surely,
and find out where that is. Because when you need that help, at least there'd be some place to get it.
Some place to turn.
Right.
You know?
Good. Where are you off to now? You?
Well, I've got to work tomorrow.
I'm
shooting on the airport film.
Right.
And
when will that be out? Later
in the
show?
I think in the fall. I'm afraid I'll be competing with myself again. I don't know that that's too good.
You have them both out at the same time?
I'm afraid that's the way it's going to work out. I hope not.
Give me a call when you want to play some tennis someday.
I was just going to say, I hope to see you on a tennis court.
I always wanted to beat Moses on a tennis court. You know, he's tough because all the guys kid him about it when he's taking them. You know, all he has to do is look up with a racket like this and everybody goes, oh, no, not again. And it's all over.
And then you say, look, Chuck, you want to fool around or you want to play tennis?
Right. Yeah. Thanks for being with us. I like him. He's a nice man. He really is. And now a word for those special people. I'm talking to you folks who own dogs. Hi there. What are we going to do when the Herb Alpert album is all used up? We only got one album per week.
Let's get some Basie tomorrow night.
Get some Count Basie.
Count Basie tomorrow night.
Or Horace Height and his musical nights. David Brenner is with us tonight. He'll be headlining at the Metro in Forest Hills, Long Island, June 5th to 9th, and at Scott's Inn in Columbus, Ohio, June 10th to 16th. And then he leaves, as he did last year. He was on a national tour with Tom Jones. He has a strange slant. There's a shingle loose somewhere with David, which is good when you do comedy. Would you welcome Mr. David Brenner?
No shingle loose. My house is falling in. That's all. I had to tell you something. I wasn't going to tell you this, but I was thinking about it because I just flew in today. And a woman came up in my building last night, and she was on the elevator. I live in New York City, and she was on the elevator. She had a shopping bag. And she took a head of lettuce out of the shopping bag, and she said, look at this, David. I just spent $1.19 for a head of lettuce. Now, I don't know what that means because I'm a bachelor. The only thing I have in my refrigerator are cigarettes and socks. So I didn't know if that was a lot of money or a little bit. So I gave her that general answer that covers everything. I went, ooh. But then I was thinking on the way out today, $1.19, that's almost the minimum wage. Now, can you imagine you're at work on your job, you're working hard for an hour sweating, and your boss comes over and hands you a head of lettuce? What is this country coming to? I don't eat at home. I only eat in restaurants. I mainly Italian restaurants. Love Italian food. I always wanted to be Italian when I was a little kid. Oh, you can put down your guns and applaud. Sorry. The reason I wanted to, mainly for protection. Italians are tough. They even their names are frightening. Tony Bellafucchio. That's a name. You know, who the hell's gonna be afraid of Sheldon Horowitz? And you ever notice everyone's named after everyone else? We're named after a relative or a friend. Did you ever notice Italians are named after parts of the body? Tony the foot. Louis the lip. Right, Andy the muscle. And it's always tough parts of the body. You'd never hear something like Guido the tushy. Friend Caruso, we call him Moose. It's unfair, he's bigger than one, but I have this friend, and he's very tough. His whole family's tough. He has tough brothers, successful, but very tough. One's in plastics, I think the other one's in cement. But here's the amazing thing. I was over his house about a week ago, and he has plants. Now, people talk to plants. Do you talk to your plant to make it grow? It's kind of weird. I mean, what do you say to a plant? Hey, you look good and green. So. I looked at him, I couldn't believe. Here's Caruso, and he's playing with the dirt and the stems and fixing the petals, and I thought, gee, he used to be so tough. Did he change? But as we were leaving his apartment, he turned around to the plants and went, grow! You can threaten him. Oh, I gotta tell you a threat. You wanna hear the greatest threat I ever heard? I was eating in a restaurant, and two men were arguing in the next booth in New York, and they're arguing up and back. You couldn't really hear what they were saying. And then, just as my food arrived, my luck, one of them turned to the other one and said, how would you like me to stick my knife in your baked potato after it's in your stomach? I twirled all my spaghetti on one forehead. It's really scary. He used to scare me. My brother was me. I have an older brother. He's about 20 years older than I am. I always thought he was my father. I did when I was a kid. He used to take me to scary movies. I love scary movies. He would take me to see, like, Frankenstein and Wolfman meet Dracula, you know, and beat him up or something. And I'd be sitting there, and, you know, the scenes were in a graveyard, and you hear dogs barking and chains rattling, and I'd be scared. And other older brothers would always turn to their kid brothers and say, don't be afraid, it's only a movie. My brother would say, this is not a movie. They live about two doors away from us. They're coming over for dinner Wednesday. You know my favorite movie of all time? King Kong. But you've got to go see it now that you're grown up, because I want you to look for scenes in there. I just saw it that I don't remember seeing when I was a kid, because I don't think I was that silly. Remember the classic scene where King Kong, the giant ape, is on top of the Empire State Building, right? And he's holding on to Fay Wray, the beautiful blonde, in his hand, 120 stories above the ground. You know what she says to him? I couldn't believe it. She says, let me go. That's crazy. Great. I mean, if I were in her place, I would have been saying things like, ooh, I dig apes. And then more unbelievable, the end of the movie. King Kong falls, 2 tons of ape fall, 120 stories, right? Hits the pavement, not even a crack. He lands like a parachute, like a gorilla feather. Okay, we'll believe that. But then King Kong lays there for 2 weeks while people walk around looking at him. That's in the heart of the garment district. They would have made coats out of him in 20 seconds. I was down at Garment District. A man said, I love the silly things we all say, silly expressions. A man said to me, he said, did you buy that across the street? I said, yeah. He said, I bet it cost you an arm and a leg. I said, no, a kneecap and 2 toes. I know the fellow at the store. You want to hear something silly that I did the other night? I said something, but I'm not ashamed of this. I'm not embarrassed. I think a lot of us do this. I couldn't find something in my apartment. You know, I was looking for about an hour. You know how frustrating that is. And then I said to myself, out loud, I said, I know when I find it, it's going to be in the last place I look. Now, that's dumb. Of course it's going to be in the last place you look. Who finds something and keeps looking for it? I think it runs in my family. My mother called me. She's a sweetheart. My mother called me to tell me that a distant cousin, like 20 times removed, passed away. And on the phone, she said, David, we're going to give him a decent burial. And I thought, what's an indecent burial? Would he leave his arm out of the ground? You know what I don't like? I don't like when people say to me, have a nice weekend. Why do they limit me to only 2 days of happiness? On the plane, I heard something silly. You know, I don't like to fly. You know, I've talked about that. And it's not superstition. Someone said I was superstitious. I was in an emergency landing once. I really was. And you know, people are silly. We are. The plane blew a tire when we landed. And the plane skidded. And when it finally came to a stop, everyone applauded. And I thought, what would they do if we crashed? Boo? Boo, bad landing, bummer. But I was on a plane a few weeks ago. The plane, nothing happened, but the plane suddenly, you know how they dip all of a sudden? They hit an air pocket, and you dip, and I saw my navel go above my head. And I'm pulling straps, I'm reading the car, breathing the oxygen. But there was a man in front of me, bless him, he must have been in his 80s. And he's sitting there, and I hear him say, I'm shaking, and he's very calm, and I hear him say, I'm not afraid. I know I'm sitting in the palm of God's hand. So I figured, great, I'm in the seat behind him, you know? I gotta be on his finger, his wrist. But I know, my luck, I'd sit in his palm, he'd wake up that morning. Well, beautiful day.
I'll tell you something we talked about before he came on, because I was talking with Chuck Heston out here about suicide before. It's the worst thing a comedian waiting to go on a show can hear. You know, I said, oh my goodness, they're talking about suicide and I gotta go out and be funny.
That's why when he mentioned young people, I said, if he keeps talking, I'm gonna be one of them.
Well, see, you disproved it.
Yeah.
You came out and you were funny. We'll take this brief pause and we'll be right back in just a moment. Friends, we're back. We're talking with David Brenner. Things are going well, right?
Yeah, for you. Excellent. You know, I'm looking forward to the Jones tour.
Huh? Work with. That's right. You go out with Crazy Tom Jones.
Man's man.
Yeah, he's an animal, isn't he?
Oh, forget
animal.
It.
Tom
women,
Jones, we're
women
talking about.
Climbing up, who needs it?
Yeah, I do a whole thing on him in my act. You know, well, like lots of people do. But you traveled with him last year, did you not?
No, I was with Humperdinck.
Humperdinck.
Yeah, Humperdinck. It's the same thing, same kind of panties come up and everything else. You know?
They do actually throw lingerie.
They actually do. I couldn't believe it. I'm up there, nothing. A napkin, nothing.
Yeah. I got an orthopedic body stocking once. Get a different crowd, but, you know, it's a start anyway. You've had a pretty good measure of success now. That's changed your life. We talked about that you had bad luck with the stock market. That didn't work out.
Oh, I did the worst thing in the stock market. I made that look minor.
Yeah.
I fixed up an apartment.
Well,
in New York. Well, that you'd look forward to, right?
Right.
And the strange thing is, I moved. See, I moved in the same building. Now, that's a little weird.
You mean you just took a bigger apartment?
I waited a year, yeah. My apartment, like, friends of mine knew I wasn't home. They'd hang up on half a ring. They knew. I could reach the phone anywhere. And the one I had is like a box. I moved into a better place in the same apartment building, waited a year. Now, I thought that was nuts. And I remember my father, and he's very funny, ex-vaudeville comedian. My father moved in Atlantic City, New Jersey, from 12th North Johnson to the house next door, 10 North Johnson. Now he moved, I mean, had moving vans moving next door, and the man's in his 70s, he's moving next door. So I thought that was crazy. I called my father, I said, why are you moving to the house next door? He said, I want to be closer to the beach.
Why not?
So I moved down and I got a decorator in from my hometown.
There's your first mistake right
there.
That
was it. And a nice guy used to be a window trimmer. And when I saw the mannequins coming in, I should have known something. Really. Forget what it cost me. I don't want to tell you how I was taken. But now he left. It was like timing. Like a week after he left, wallpaper starts to curl down. And beams. I put beams up. You know,
what do you get the rustic?
They fall. The beams fall. Now I can only invite short friends over. And originally, the living room was like Mediterranean. Early Spanish. Now it looks like London, 1941. It's disgusting. Isn't funny?
You gotta do it yourself. Decorators can kill you. Did a light just go off here a moment ago?
Yeah.
What? Did we lose a light?
Right behind you.
I can't do that.
It's been a great week for us. No music, the lights. They're turning out the lights one at a time. Isn't this the time of year they cancel shows? So networks don't want to do it all at once. They'll say, turn a light out each night. And when you come in and they can't see you, they say, gee, we're awfully sorry. Kind of sweet of them. It doesn't come all at once. Just one light at a time. That's the way Dinah Shore got it. One of her burners wouldn't go on her range.
wanted to make something. The back burner wouldn't go on, and she knew she was in trouble. We'll take a brief pause here, but we'll be right back. Yes, we will, with Norman Mailer and Ian Whitcomb. Thank you, guys. Norman Mailer is with us tonight. He's a most interesting, I hate that word interesting, controversial, I guess, figure in the journalistic world since he first came out with Naked and Dead some 25 years ago. Currently, he's contributed the text for a fascinating book called The Faith of Graffiti, and he's won the Pulitzer Prize and the National Book Award. Would you welcome Mr. Norman Mailer? Somewhere else, where the other day that graffiti is really plural. True?
I hope not. Oh, no. You mean the word?
Yeah, word graffiti is plural, and I'd never thought about that.
I was thinking you meant graffitis. I was thinking of my title, The Faith of Graffitis.
The Faith of. What would be the singular of. Or is there no singular?
Graffito.
Graffito?
Graffito is singular.
Didn't know that before.
Well, I've heard people say graffito. I don't really know if such a word exists, but.
Yeah.
Really, it's a plural word. Right. You know, it almost has no meaning taken by itself. It's the fact that a lot of people do it.
Yeah, where did it come from? Did you ever check into the derivation? Now, maybe people don't know what graffiti is, and it's almost a new art form all of itself. I suppose when people wrote Kilroy was here in World War II, that was a kind of graffiti?
Yeah, that was the beginning of it.
Is it the desire to have something of your own emblazoned? Is it like the people who go out on rocks, which I hate? You drive through a beautiful park or something, and you see people who've gone up and chiseled their name and say Bill and Jane 1939 and carve something. Is it that desire, the ego, to be permanently emblazoned somewhere?
It's got a great deal to do with ego, but it's a funny phenomenon. You know, to begin with, most people, when you talk about graffiti, most people think of bathroom graffiti.
Yeah.
And I wish there really were two words, because what I'm writing about is subway graffiti.
Yeah. Let me just show them this picture, first of all. Where's this from? This is New York?
Yeah, they're all from New York, all the pictures.
And some of it, believe it or not, is quite artistic in nature. It's some kind of an expression.
Well, if you look at the, if you notice, all the names on the left are small, relatively. And on the right, you see the beginning of star.
Yeah, we'll pan over there. Right.
That one on the right that's large, star three, is called a masterpiece. The definition of a masterpiece is that it is anywhere from 3 to 6 feet high, the letters, and it's about anywhere from 10 to 60 feet long. Mm-hmm. There are masterpieces that cover the entire side of a subway car.
Right.
And on top of that, they take a lot of time to paint, which is the crucial difference. In other words, that probably took at least 30 minutes and maybe an hour to do. Now, since they're doing it in a subway yard,
right,
with one eye over their shoulder, waiting for the cops,
right,
it takes a lot of grace under pressure to do it.
Now, a lot of people would say, hey, that's nothing but vandalism and defacing public property and so forth. Did you find out a lot about this and what causes it? And
well, it's of course, technically, it's vandalism. There's no question legally that it's vandalism. And in fact, some kids have been arrested. A good many of them get beaten up when they're caught. They're afraid of getting beaten up. I mean, that's part of the pressure of it. But, you know, what are they defacing? They're defacing ugly subway stations. They're defacing bare, blank walls in cities that are terribly dull.
Right.
I mean, they bring a little color to the environment. So I've never felt that they were really defacing so much as improving the environment. Nobody ever asked themselves whether a corporation has the right to build a huge, blank office building that 100,000 people have to look at every day on the way to work.
Right.
I mean, you look at those buildings and you get a little depressed.
Not too aesthetic, yeah.
And, well, it's more than that almost. It's a feeling of, my God, the world's big and it's blank, and it makes you feel smaller. And I think a lot of this is not just simply individual ego, although there's a lot of that in it, but there's also a certain sense of almost a collective ego. I mean, the kids really do band together and cooperate.
Right.
One of the things that characterizes, they never write over each other's handwriting. They really try to avoid that. So that in all the chaos, apparently, of these drawings, if you look at it closely, you see there's very, very little overwriting.
Yeah.
And when it is, they tend to almost overwrite in such a way that they don't ruin the signature below. We could put on any one of these. I think I could show you that.
Yeah, we'll get one, some illustration here. I don't know whether they could.
This would be a good example.
Yeah, if you can get close enough on this. This is in a tunnel wall. And as you say, the tunnel wall itself is kind of boring. It's blank.
really has no character. And you'll see here that it's almost surrealistic in form. Now, come in real close on some of these things. This is New York City, I would assume, again.
Yeah, it's an underpass, you know, and it looks just a big, shiny, white porcelain place, very dull. Looks like a, you know, men's room, a huge men's room for whales, maybe. And then you've got all that careful little drawing. Looks like little plants, foliage. And the only thing I'd ask of it is that it would grow another 8 feet so it covers the entire wall.
But as you say, nobody has seemed to overlap or destroyed anybody else's.
I think we'd have to go in closer to see
that.
Yeah,
can you go in a little closer on that and just we'll get another, come in a little closer with the camera. Is this a recent phenomenon? Has graffiti been with us? But there's been such an upsurge of this kind of graffiti just in the last few years. Which is really new in that sense.
It really hit its peak in New York about a year ago. Mm-hmm. And when I wrote the book, I thought it was all over. The tone of my piece in the book, incidentally, the book consists of much more than my piece. I wrote a piece for the book. And the book has something like 50 beautiful photographs by a photographer named John Knarr.
Right.
Which came first. I saw the photographs first and then wanted to write the book. But John Lindsay hated this graffiti. Hated it because I think he felt it was doing more to undermine his administration than almost anything around. He used to fight it tooth and nail, you know, after he was a great champion of the ghetto, but he did hate this aspect of it, hated it. And so toward the end of his administration, I think he wanted to turn over a clean house.
Right, so.
And he put on a big push to end graffiti and partially succeeded, so that while I was writing this piece, the subway trains were sort of half scrubbed over. You know, they all look really dirty now because the graffiti had been wiped off and just smudges were left. And back of that, there was very little new stuff coming on. Now, since Beam has come in, it's as if it started all over again. And so the tone in which I wrote this is already just a tiny bit outdated. It looks like there's going to be a new wave of graffiti which might be bigger than the last one.
Did you find, does this have anything to do with obscenity? Did you find much,
no.
Or whatever that definition yeah. is, but what I'm talking about? The kind of words that would, it doesn't seem to be in most of it.
See, that's bathroom graffiti,
right.
is obscene, almost always. Or else it's witty, you know, but, or presidential in its tone.
But, right.
But this stuff is, this stuff has almost no interest in words as such.
In shock value, yeah.
It's interested in the name, and they all pick a name that's not their own. And then it's interested in painting. They call writing. They talk about writing your name. Or they'll say, I hit the name 50 times today, or I wrote the name, you know, 25 times today, or whatever. But what they're really doing is they're painting. It's a form of painting. I mean, they're taking color and then putting forms up on a wall.
Did you talk to many of these? And it's mainly a youthful phenomenon, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I must have talked to altogether maybe 15 or 20 kids, and maybe four or five I talked to quite a while. And most of them are black or Puerto Rican, and they run in age. Most of them around 13 or 14, 15.
And it has to be an identification thing, doesn't it? I mean.
Oh, very much. And also, it's sort of a general agreement that they usually stop doing it about the time they get heavy interest in girls. Although some women are also doing it.
So. Right.
And it's sort of, the kids have a, well, they have a great awareness of what everyone else is doing in it. You know, in other words, there are areas that run from about 110th Street in Manhattan, clear up to, parts of the North Bronx, I'd say.
Did you find a different kind of graffiti?
Well, there's styles. You know, it's a technical subject. You get into Brooklyn graffiti, Bronx graffiti, Manhattan graffiti. There's a Broadway style, so on and so forth. But I think, you know, we could get into it, but we'd never get out of it. And the main thing is this awareness they all have of what everyone's doing.
Right.
So that they'll hear various people doing things clear across the city. And, of course, there's a fellow named Hugo Martinez who got the best of them together and formed a pretty much a working union. And some of them actually sold some of these their graffiti on canvases for as much as $2,000 to $3,000 at the Razor Gallery in New York.
So don't knock it, maybe the...
Well, I think some of them have had their lives obviously changed by it and have had careers beginning. But that's not the main element. The main element is that these kids are really doing it because it's a way of contending with the government. I've always felt that the toughest, you know, problem maybe that democracy ever faces is that we have the sense we have no effect on it.
Right.
We can vote, but that's about all we can generally do. We don't participate.
This way they get some kind of reaction from what is happening.
Yeah, I think so. I think they have a feeling that at least maybe they're not part of the power, but at least they're making the power very nervous and unhappy, and they enjoy that.
So. Let me interrupt for a moment. We will be back after the latest look at People magazine. We're back. We're talking to Norman Mailer, first of all, about the fate of graffiti. You really have to see the book. It's actually fascinating. And it surely is an art form. Beautiful photographs in there. I read somewhere, you're working on a new novel. I suppose it's always a dumb question to ask a writer what it's about, because it's difficult to explain in a kind of succinct terminology what goes into a book. But
I can tell you what it's not about.
Yeah, all right, we'll start there.
Because what it's not about is what was reported in the newspapers.
What did they say it was about, or not about?
Well, in the newspapers it was said that that it's a book about a nice Jewish family that starts with the pyramids and goes forth through time into a spaceship. Now, you know, there are great...
Where would they get that?
Well, I got my suspicions about where they got it, but I can't prove it. You'd have to use Lenin's old formula of whom does this benefit?
Uh-huh.
It didn't benefit the publisher, and it didn't benefit me, so I got a third party, but I can't accuse them.
All right. No supporting evidence.
No supporting evidence. Say, you know what I thought? Instead of talking about this novel,
sure.
Which after all, I'm not really going to talk about it, because I think it's bad luck to talk about a novel.
Okay.
I'll just say it's going to be a very long novel. I'm going to be working on it for about 5 to 7 years, and it's going to be about 500 to 700,000 words. And both those are impossibilities. Instead of me, that's impossible that I work on anything.
Five to seven years.
And also, nobody reads a book that's, 500 to 700,000 words.
So then why are you writing a book 500 to 700,000 words?
Well, I want to see if it can be done, truly. I mean, I've had this idea for all my life, just about, and I really want to, it would be fun to see if it's possible to write a book that's 2,000 pages long, say, that's just truly readable.
Can you stay at peak writing form for that length of time?
Well, of course, over 7 years, you don't have to be at peak writing form every day.
Right.
But half the days, you do have to be over that period. It's a long stretch. But what I did want to talk about is something else altogether, which is I just finished a book by a man named Robert Slater called The Life and Curious Death of Marilyn Monroe. And in it, at the end of it, he did an awful lot of work about her death. He did all the work that, in effect, I didn't do and should have done.
Right, because you were a subject of...
I was writing under a tremendous deadline.
Pretty heavy criticism there, that you, it was a superficial job and
you did it to make a quick buck.
And all of that.
Well, I didn't do it to make a quick buck, but it was a superficial job because I promised to do a preface and I got to a full-length book and there was no time left. But at any rate, Slater's book really presents such a massive amount of evidence for the possibility of the murder that you're left with the feeling that it's going to be harder now to prove that she did commit suicide than that she was murdered. And I think it's going to be kind of a shocker if people pay any attention to this, because he calls for a coroner's investigation, a coroner's inquest of it. And I think there's enough
evidence
here.
Even now, you mean?
Yeah.
That's fascinating. Now, I had not heard that. Those things usually are never resolved, are they, unless there's absolutely hard rock evidence, because the principal is gone, and you have to reconstruct everything from witnesses from 10 years ago, and where do you end up in the long haul?
Well, you can't ever, I don't think it would ever be a matter of finding who the murderer was.
Right.
Or whether, what you can find out is whether there's any chance it was a suicide, or whether it was impossible it was a suicide. I think the coroner's inquest could establish that much, because there's a huge amount of evidence. Just a tiny example of it, just a tiny little detail. She was found in the nude, allegedly taking sleeping pills. One coroner, who's one of the most distinguished coroners in America, said that in all his experience of 20 years, no woman ever committed suicide taking sleeping pills in the nude. One woman had shot herself in the nude.
Right.
But no woman had ever done that. Well, you could advance the argument that Marilyn Monroe was used to living in the nude, and if any woman was ever going to do it, be Marilyn Monroe. You see, in other words, it's not overwhelming evidence.
You can take the other side, yes.
Then you have that matter that she died without anything in her stomach and a huge overdose in her veins, which points very heavily toward an injection.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I've talked to any number of coroners.
I wasn't aware that it was an injection.
Well, the coroner's report says nothing of an injection. But there are all sorts of rumors about that. One of the things that Slater points up is there was a 700-page investigation by the police, an original report that was 700 pages long that was boiled down to 52 pages. And he wants to know what happened to the other 650 pages.
Well, are you inferring that there was an attempt at, or there could be an attempt at some cover-up then?
Slater's flat out about it, but there was a cover-up. He quotes a police officer named Jack Clemens, who was in the Los Angeles Police Department, who feels that everybody involved there was lying because, the death, according to Clemens, occurred first at 10:30 in the morning. I beg your pardon, 10:30 in the evening.
That's right.
Because of the rigor mortis. He arrived about 4:30. And by his experience as a police officer, he was certain she'd been dead at least 6 hours. And he was convinced that the doctors had been there. And so his argument was that everybody involved was not telling the truth.
Were there not people who had talked with her previous to that time, up until several hours before the time of death was established, according to what I've read?
No one apparently has talked to her after 10:30. Then also the chief of police in Los Angeles, Parker, pulled all the telephone calls that had been made. Mm-hmm. He kept them. Right. This man, Clemens, was fired from the force a month later. Now, of course, he could have been a disgruntled cop, or it could have been fired because he knew too much and was beginning to complain and wanted. He was not in charge of the investigation, and he wanted to be. Well, this is just a little bit of the evidence. There's much, much more in this book.
That's fascinating. Actually, yes, I didn't know all that. Is that book out now?
It's just coming out right about now.
We've opened up a whole new.
I think it's really going to open the case.
We have to cut away. I'm sorry. We'll be right back. Now, well, that's a fascinating theory, and you never know for sure whether those, as I say, what will they accomplish in the long run anyways? You said if they don't know the truth,
what good does it establish?
Let's assume.
Jack, I think there's one thing that's really important.
Yeah, Johnny. That's all right. That's okay.
There's never a man named John who can't be called Jack. Isn't that so?
Okay, Fred.
No,
I know what you're saying.
Alfred,
they are intertwined.
You can call me something awful like Norm. Well, I won't tell you what you call me. It's awful because everybody would call me that. But okay, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
John. Look, everybody has lived for years with the idea that Marilyn Monroe was a tragic suicide.
Mm-hmm.
And what that meant was that the perils of female adventuring out into the extensions of their own personality were doom. In other words, if you really tried to be a bold woman, you were destroyed by yourself. And what if instead she was really coming around the bend and beginning to put her life together, and she got killed? And she didn't kill herself. There's a huge difference there. There's a difference in our history, because she was one of our culture heroines.
You haven't discussed any motive yet without even getting her intimating any people or personalities or such.
I'd rather not, because I think it talking about it too quickly could really be bad. But let me just say this much about it. It was obvious that there are some people who think, and I don't agree with them, that the Kennedys, if there was a murder, the Kennedys would have had something to do with it. And I think that's absolute nonsense for a simple reason, which is that the Kennedys were extraordinarily sophisticated people. If ever anyone in the history of this country knew how to handle publicity and bad publicity and were not afraid of it, it was the Kennedys, starting with Joe Kennedy, and Jack certainly knew how to handle his publicity, and Bobby did too. But I think there were people who wanted to damage the Kennedys.
Mm-hmm.
The Kennedys had many enemies all over the place. They had enemies in the CIA, the FBI, and in the trade unions. And there were any number of people who knew that something was going on between Marilyn Monroe and Bobby Kennedy. It doesn't mean that they were necessarily even having an affair.
Mm-hmm.
But the general opinion in Hollywood at the time was that they were.
Well, that's opinion, right?
Well, but what they felt, and as a matter of fact, they were right to a certain extent, was that there'd be a tremendous amount of bad publicity about it.
Mm-hmm.
And more, maybe. It may be the murder, if it was a murder, was sufficiently clumsy so that it might have been that the intent, if it was particularly clever, might have been to make it look like a suicide first, then the police would quickly penetrate that, discover a murder, and then it might have been the worst publicity in the world for the Kennedys. Because even though if they could have proved absolutely that they had absolutely nothing to do with it, which is very hard always to do,
mm-hmm.
half the country would never have believed it.
Mm-hmm.
So that there could have been a tremendously serious intent here. Now, that's quite different from a lonely girl who never quite managed to succeed with success killing herself.
Yeah.
And we are building our history and our idea of what our history is.
But as Chuck Heston said earlier, did he not? I didn't mean to interrupt you. Didn't he say that she had intimated in her previous thing that attempts or had suggested it herself to friends that she might possibly...
She tried to commit suicide 10 or 12 times, at least in her life.
So there's certainly a pattern there of...
The fact that she could have committed suicide is obviously there. Everybody assumed it was a suicide because of her many attempts in the past. But the point is, if you're going to commit suicide by taking sleeping pills, and you take 50 pills, let's say, there's all sorts of records left in your body.
Mm-hmm.
There are pills left in your stomach. You know, by the time you die from the 50 pills, you don't die after digesting all 50 pills. You die after digesting half the 50 pills.
Mm-hmm.
The other half are still in your stomach in one form or another. There was nothing in her stomach. There was an ounce of a meaningless liquid. There was nothing in her intestine that we know about. because the intestine, the small intestine, was removed for study. Mm-hmm. You see, because if it passes through the stomach, it doesn't pass through the small intestine. But when I asked the coroner, Thomas Noguchi, what had happened to the small intestine, he said that they hadn't examined it. And I said, well, you say on your report that you removed it for study, why didn't you examine it? He said, well, there weren't the facilities. And I said, you mean in Los Angeles in 1962, after the death of Marilyn Monroe, there weren't the facilities to examine a small intestine? He said, no, there weren't.
I thank you very much. Fascinating theory. We can follow up on that and see what happens.
Okay.
Thank you, Norman. Thank you, David, for being with us. Tomorrow night, Ava Gabor, Artie Shaw, The Persuasions from the San Diego Zoo, Joan Embry will be with us, and the Mighty Carson Art Players will tackle something else. Thank you. Good night. I'm humbled by that applause.